Preparing my talk, the last week I was thinking that I have been given more or less an impossible task with this title, how to diagnose a heart defect in only 50 minutes. So I think that it takes years and years and years before you master that. So I changed it a little bit in how to recognize that something is wrong. I think it doesn't need introduction that the examination of the fetal heart is very important, being the most prevalent congenital anomaly in live-born children. And if you detect a heart defect prenatally, you can adjust postnatal management, which really changes the mortality numbers. It gives you time for genetic analysis, and in severe cases, there is a possibility of termination within the constraints of the law. What I really want to stress out that there is a difference between screening and diagnosing. Screening more or less, and I think that is the most important task for everybody, is to identify abnormal, as illustrated by this nice picture on the right side, that you see that the animal second from the right is a different animal compared to the other ones. So screening is identifying normal from abnormal. Diagnosis is categorizing the defect, and that is the task for specialists. I think you all are familiar with the ISWOG guidelines. Jeline Carvalho talked 2 days ago in this insight session about that, so I will skip this slide for the reasons of time. But look at these pictures carefully, because they will come back in my next slides. So for diagnosing a fetal heart defect, the title of my task, I was thinking, what should I present if I only have 50 minutes? So I thought I'd bring you 3 different defects, which I illustrate you with the ISWOG guidelines to recognize how you can see that they are abnormal. And I specifically selected 3 defects that are frequently missed. So let's move on to the first case. This case is only 16 weeks old, and if you see, it is a normal-sized lady, but very perfect images at only 16 weeks old. We start with the 4-chamber view, the first plane of the ISWOG guidelines. And I think the most important message of today is that you do your examination systematically. And systematically means sequential, and that means that you assess the heart segment for segment. And my advice would be start with the venous return to the heart, then assess the atria, then the AV valves, then the ventricles, and then the outflow tracts. So this is the 4-chamber view. The first thing you have to be sure is that you have a proper transverse plane. And a transverse plane, if you are in the right plane, you can identify by seeing the rib. If you see a complete rib, then you know for sure that you are in a good transverse plane of a fetus. Then secondly, you assess the pulmonary venous return at the left atrium, the right atrium, and both ventricles. One screening tool which is very important and which is not used often is the cardiac axis. The cardiac axis is aligned through the ventricular septum, which makes an angle of around 45 degrees with the line that you draw from the spine to the sternum. So this axis has to be more or less 45 degrees. So I think you all appreciate that this is more or less a normal 4-chamber view with also equally sized ventricles. This is again a very important item to assess in the 4-chamber view, and that will be illustrated by the second case, but not in this case. So a normal 4-chamber view, but this fetus is having a critically heart defect postnatally. So don't be comforted by this very normal 4-chamber view. Again, 16 weeks old. Then we go to the outflow tract, and at the right side, I depicted the picture of the ISWOG guidelines. And what I really appreciate, if you follow the aortic root a little bit further than the 5-chamber view of the ISWOG guidelines, that you see here. Left ventricle outflow tract, And if you are critical, you see that the left ventricle outflow tract bends a little bit more to the left side. So it has a slightly abnormal course, and that is important to recognize. Then we go to the three-vessel view, also a transverse plane. Again, you are comforted by a full rib in your picture, so you know that you are in a good transverse plane. Here, a normal three-vessel view, and there you see that you are missing one of the vessels. This is a two-vessel view, pointing towards the diagnosis of this fetus. I think most of you know by now that this is a baby of 16 weeks old with transposition of the great arteries. I want to say a little bit more about transposition because most people in this room are taught to look for crossing of the arteries. And if the great arteries are crossing, that there is no transposition. And that is an important message that I want to give to you because I think please forget crossing of the arteries. This is the same baby with transposition of the arteries. Here you see the left ventricular outflow tract at the right side depicted with color. Have to wait a little bit for in the clip. That is the course of the left ventricular outflow tract. Then I wait again a little bit in the clip. That is the course of the right ventricular outflow tract. So there is some kind of crossing. Okay, the crossing is not normal, but there is more or less crossing. So please forget about the crossing, look at the three-vessel view, and look how abnormal the three-vessel view is. That will guide you towards your diagnosis and not the absence of crossing. The parallel course of the outflow tract, as is depicted here, is not always that easy to obtain. Sometimes this image, where you see the parallel course of the outflow tract, is an oblique plane through the fetus, so that is really difficult to ascertain. Transposition, as being said, the detection rates are low. Please forget the sign absence of crossing and assess the three-vessel view. And why is this important? Because these babies have a life-threatening condition after birth, but have an excellent outcome after the arterial switch. Let's move on to the second case. Again, I start with a four-chamber view, the starting point of every cardiac examination. Again, I'm comforted by the good transverse plane through the chest. If you see the rib, you are assured that you are in a good position. You are in a transverse plane. But if you look carefully, you see that the ventricles are slightly asymmetrical, which is measured here. So at this point, please do not think that you are not scanning well and that you have an oblique plane, because you haven't. You have a good transverse plane, and this four-chamber view is asymmetrical, which is a very, very, very important sign. Let's go to the outflow tract. Here, the left ventricular outflow tract is retrieved. Here you see the left ventricle, the right ventricle outflow tract with the pulmonary valve. And again, you see here asymmetry. Here, the left ventricle outflow tract. And I will put the clip on pause that we can do a sort of Sine loop. Go a little bit backwards. Look at the size of the left ventricle outflow tract, the aorta. If you measure this and compare it to the right ventricle outflow tract, you see that it is really asymmetrical. Both valves are open, both arteries have good forward flow, so don't let you be comfortable because they are open, they are asymmetrical. And look at the three-vessel view. The aorta, the ascending aorta, is almost as big as the SVC. That is not normal. The aorta should be bigger. The aorta should have the size of the pulmonary artery. Look at the difference in size. If you are educated well, you know at this point that these signals are signals of coarctation of the aorta. This is the same fetus, 20 weeks old. And then you see that the aortic arch is fairly normal. But again, don't let you be comforting by this plane. because it can still be a coarctation. This image, this plane, the three-vessel trachea view with color Doppler really solves all the questions that you have. Again, I put it on pause, and I scroll through it image by image. Here you see that the aortic arch is narrower than compared to the ductal arch. And if I move through the clip, you see forward flow in systole, but here, very nicely depicted, backward flow in the aortic arch in diastole. And that is really a sign of coarctation. So this baby ended up, as being said, with aortic coarctation. I think these images are very important because coarctation, again, is a life-threatening condition if not recognized before birth, but has extremely low detection rates. In most countries, not above 20, maybe 30%. Furthermore, asymmetry in the four-chamber view has another side effect. If you see that, the problem is that almost half of the cases have coarctation, but the other half have postnatal admission to survey ductal closure, but end up without coarctation. So this is really a difficult prenatal finding, but it is globally accepted that the severity of the condition warrants this approach. Yeah, I think we have time for the third case. For the third case, I really would like to go to the three-vessel view and point out some important features within the three-vessel view. Here is a picture of the three-vessel view. I think one of the important things to assess in the three-vessel view are, as previously being said, the symmetry of the size of the ascending aorta and the pulmonary trunk. Furthermore, you should look for the pulmonary valve, and if you draw a line from the pulmonary valve towards the upper border of the SVC, the aorta should be beneath it. This is something which isn't being taught much, but if the aorta is anteriorly positioned here, that is a sign of an abnormality, which is shown in the next case that I will demonstrate. Here it is. This is a baby of 20 weeks old. Again, a full rib in your screen, so you know that you are in a good transverse plane. A more or less normal four-chamber view. The only thing is, if you look carefully, the cardiac axis is almost 90 degrees. It is more than 45. It's not completely 90, but the cardiac axis is too wide. Let's move to the outflow tracks. This baby is moving a little bit, and I will put it on pause to see clip by clip, and that stresses the importance also of your sinus loop on your machine. Here is the left ventricle outflow tract with the VSD. And you see that if the clip is running in a normal speed, that it is very difficult to see. But if you scroll back, use your sinus loop, look image by image, you see that there is a VSD. And here the bright white spots help you in identifying the VSD. If you miss that, which is sometimes difficult to see, then again, for this diagnosis, the three-vessel view will help you with the trick that I taught you. Here you see the pulmonary trunk with branching, which is very important in identification of the great arteries. And if you scroll back, you see that here the pulmonary valve is positioned. If you draw a line in the three-vessel view from the pulmonary valve towards the SVC, you see that the aorta is fully positioned anteriorly from this line. Again, I will run the clip that you can see it with the moving, beating heart. Here is the pulmonary valve. Here is the SVC, and you see the artery positioned anteriorly of this line. A second feature which I want to point out is that the ascending aorta is far bigger than the pulmonary artery. This one is normally sized. This one is too small. All these features are giving you the diagnosis. This was a case with tetralogy of Fallot. In most cases with tetralogy, there is no acute emergency after birth. So a lot of people say, why bother? Why should we have a prenatal diagnosis for Fallot cases? I do not agree with that, because I think in these cases there is a high prevalence of genetic syndromes which are worthwhile to diagnose before birth. And with the increasing possibilities of genetics testing, even other syndromes like CHARGE or more severe genetic syndromes can be diagnosed prenatally nowadays. Furthermore, sometimes the pulmonary valve is very obstructive and the defect needs prostin after birth. So there is drug dependency in some cases. Thus, in my opinion, it is worthwhile to diagnose them. With the approach that I've shown you, this I have taught in my country for some years already now, and you can see that with introducing the three-vessel view in 2002 in our screening program, the rates for detection of transposition got up to about 80%, but also with pointing out the position of the aorta within the three-vessel view, we had an increase of detection of Fallot cases as well, heading towards 80% as well. So that is pointing out the importance of the spatial relationship of the aorta and the pulmonary artery within the three-vessel view. So this is my last slide before we start the live session. I think it is very, very important to assess symmetry within all the planes that you obtain, to look for symmetry of the atria and the ventricles, to look for symmetry in the outflow tracts and preferably to measure them. And if they are asymmetrical, please refer. And furthermore, use the three-vessel view and look for asymmetry within the three-vessel view as well. A lot of these clips that I showed you today are on the website fetalheartacademy.nl. So if you want to look at an image library, you are very welcome. It is for free. Start with the position of the baby. The head is down. Start with, the stomach is left. The heart is pointing towards the left side, the apex of the heart. And as being said, I always start with a four-chamber view. The arm is a little bit in the way. I have to stress that you use proper presets. So I touch the fetal heart preset, and now the baby is turning. Let's see what the best. It's very awake. When a baby is awake like this, it is important not to move your transducer too much and to keep it still, because the baby will come to you. And I cannot say often enough that the Sine loop is very important, because now we have a very short clip which already gives you a lot of information. Four-chamber view, symmetry of both atria. Here you see the pulmonary veins entering the left atria. Mitral valve, tricuspid valve, right ventricle, left ventricle. And I will depict the ventricles a little bit better than I have now. But the atria are already nicely visible with the crux. And if you look carefully and scroll your image back, you can see also the offset of the AV valves. The offset of the mitral valve is a little bit higher than the offset of the tricuspid valve, which is normal and should be. I was not really satisfied with the depiction. Oh, the baby is totally different position at the moment. Let's see where it moved to. Here it is. What I wanted to say that I, with that previous clip, I was not really satisfied. With the depiction of the ventricles, but now it's getting better. And again, I very carefully do not move my transducer too much, because if I move my transducer too much, then the baby will move as well. Now here the opening and the closing of the valve. The moderator band is very nicely depicted in the right ventricle, and the left ventricle is triangular shaped, forming the apex of the heart. And again, we look at the width of the ventricles. And you may measure it. If you are in doubt, if it is fully symmetrical, it is okay to assess it with just eyeballing. Let's see where the baby moved to. It's now in the same position. This is called an apical four-chamber view, which is not ideal to assess the ventricular septum. So I move towards the outflow tracts, which is feasible in this position. And I can't stress enough that you should use your Sina loop. And here is a nice left ventricular outflow tract. This is one of the planes that is not a transverse plane. So for this plane, you don't need to see a full rip. And now the baby is moved fully. So I... Let's see where it moved to. Okay, again, starting with the four-chamber view, and I think this is possible to get the three-vessel view. Move slightly up. I have a hand. Yeah, there it comes. Ja, vergroot maar. What we are seeing here, even with this difficult position, it is possible to see the branching of the pulmonary artery. But the position of the baby is now difficult to really making a full cardiac exam. But if you look carefully, you can see here the branching of the pulmonary artery. Here is the valve, and this is the ascending aorta. So the identification of the right outflow tract is being done at this moment. It's getting slightly better. And here is a very nice example of the three-vessel trachea view. Here is the trachea, here is the SVC, and this is the aortic arch. And if you compare that to the case that I show you, you see that here is a nice patent aortic arch with a good size, equally sized two arches. What I also really would like to show you is the pulmonary veins. Let's see if the baby allows that. Yes. What is very nice for that is the ADF flows. If you are looking for pulmonary veins, you should adjust the speed. because of course the blood flow is has very low velocity. And here you see very nice pulmonary veins entering the left atrium. And if you adjust your settings a bit, it gets even more better. Here the blue ones. And you can even see them combine going to the left atrium. Are there questions from the audience that people want to, things people want to see?
Yeah, something specific. Yeah, just a moment.
Let's see if I can.
Hi, my name is Man from Australia. What is the most adequate way to assess the septum?
The most adequate way to septum. I will show you. In my opinion, if you know the physics of ultrasound, it is not adequate to assess the septum in an apical four-chamber view. So let's go to your question. If the baby is positioned like this, it is, and you have really the apex at 12 o'clock, then it is impossible to assess the ventricle septum adequately. The most ideal position to assess the septum, I think, is in an angle of 45 degrees like this, because it combines lateral resolution with your Doppler, with the capability of the Doppler depiction of a ventricular septum defect. What I always like very much, especially when there is abnormalities, is to have this duplex kind of visualization in which at the left side you see the B image and at the right side you see the color Doppler image. And again, the velocities are quite high, so I would put them down a tiny little bit towards, if you have a gestational age around 20 weeks, towards 40, more or less 40. And what is, I think, very, very important, again, to use your Sine loop, because sometimes you do not see them in the fast-moving heart, and if you go image by image, then you see them. And if you suspect a VSD, for instance here in the mid-muscular septum, then what you should look out for to identify an artifact from a real VSD is that VSDs have a flow that go forth and back. So they are red, blue, red, blue. Is that an answer to your question?
One more questions? Another one. Okay.
It's me again.
Yeah.
You don't seem to be concentrating a lot on the aortic arch and ductal arch. Is that the three vessel views seem to be more sufficient? Thank you.
If I understand the question correctly, is that you are saying that I stressed the arches so much, and the question is if you should not forget the three vessel view. I fully agree. I had to choose some topics for this task, for this talk, and I was thinking which kind of defects are missed frequently, and that's why I'm a little bit talking about the aortic arch. But that doesn't mean that you should forget the three vessel view. I think the baby is getting in a better position at the moment for the three vessel view. Here you see again the upper part of the right ventricle. And what is very important is to see the lateral branching, which the baby is showing very nicely at the moment. This is very important. A very important feature of the three vessel view. If you are able to depict the right pulmonary artery, then you are really, really a high-skilled sonographer, and that is making your three vessel view perfect. This time, I think.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Monique, for the excellent presentation, the demonstration.